Good afternoon. We're here at the Morse Institute Library in Natick, Massachusetts. It's Thursday, May 14th, 1998, and we are interviewing Mr. Robert L. Matier. Good afternoon, Mr. Matier.
Good afternoon.
I'm going to ask you a few questions about yourself and your family, and then we'll get into some of your experiences.
Okay.
As I mentioned, your name is Robert L. Matier. Do you go by Bob?
Yes, I do.
Okay. And do you mind me asking your age?
In another 2 or 3 months, I'm going to be 80. So work back from there.
And your current address?
In Natick.
And your current marital status?
Married.
You are married. How long have you been married?
39, 40 years, something like that.
And your wife's name?
Edna.
Edna.
Mm-hmm.
And do you have children?
No.
Where were you born and
in
raised?
In Texas.
You were born in Texas. Mm-hmm. What part of Texas?
Hearne.
And how do you spell that?
H-E-A-R-N-E.
And were you raised in Texas?
No. Where Kansas.
Kansas. Mm-hmm. And what part of Kansas?
Place called Kingman.
Kingman, Kansas.
About an hour's drive west of Wichita.
What was it like growing up in Kingman, Kansas?
Had wheat fields all around me.
Uh-huh. And your family, did you have brothers and sisters?
Oh yes, I was the youngest of seven.
Youngest of seven. And what did your dad do?
He was a veterinarian. But I never saw him.
Because of his work?
Well, no, it wasn't the family lived a number of years in Texas, but apparently there were some problems between mom and pop. And that was what the cause was of our moving to Kansas, because they split down there. Dad went to Arizona, and Mama said, no, I'm not going with you anymore. So she took the whole brood, such as was left, and went up to Kansas to the old homestead up there.
And did she support you on the homestead?
Yes. Yeah.
Was it a farming homestead?
No. Mm-hmm. In the town of Kingman, it was about 3,000 population, and it was... The question here that I did all sorts of odd jobs to supplement the income, but mother was all by herself raising the family, although we did have some income from my older sisters and brothers. It was a case that mother took in washing and did all sorts of odd jobs in order to pay the rent sort of thing.
Did your dad support you all in any way?
No.
When and where did you enter the military?
It was in August of 1941.
And what prompted you to enter, and what branch of the military?
Well, first of all, I was drafted, because that was when the draft first started. It was in 1941, and that was in Kansas, and I was inducted at Fort Leavenworth, which is not far from Kansas City.
Did friends of yours go in with you?
No.
You went by yourself. How old were you then?
25, 26, something like that.
Were you single at the time?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And so you were drafted, basically, you almost had no choice.
That was it.
Mm-hmm.
You went.
Once you went in, and it was in the Army?
Yes.
Where did you have your basic training?
What little bit there was at Fort Leavenworth, but that was a very short duration.
Approximately how long?
Probably 2 weeks.
Was it because they were in the midst of war?
No, not yet.
Mm-hmm. What was basic training like in those 3+ weeks?
Very hard to describe, yet it was very simple. The conditions of the military in this country was so depleted. We had nothing to train with except to go out and march. We had some old World War I rifles that were available, and that's what we had for fighting if we ever had to fight. And from that point on, it was just a question that how long we're going to be there, because everything was in an awful rush by that stage. Congress and the President were really going all out to get things done, even though Pearl Harbor had not happened at that point. They knew that something was coming. We didn't know it, but the people in Washington were well aware of it. And as a result of that, they kept pushing. And that's the reason when I saw the chance to get into the U.S. Army Air Corps through the ads that they had on the walls at Fort Leavenworth, I jumped at the chance, because it gave me a good chance to learn a skilled trade. And from that point on, I was sent to as they call it out there, JB, which stood for Jefferson Barracks, in St. Louis. And I was there for about 2 weeks and then shipped up by train to Chanute Field, Illinois, which was very close to Champaign-Urbana, which is the home of University of Illinois. We had nothing to do with university at all. It just simply happened to be the location of the technical training that the U.S. Army Air Corps had at that time for what they called A&E mechanics, which stood for airplane and engine mechanics.
And how long was the training?
Not nearly long enough. Again, Washington was really pushing on this thing. I think the prescribed time under, shall we say, peacetime conditions were about a year. They pushed us through in 3 months. And we had to do KP on top of that about every third or fourth month. And we thought there's something bad going on here because this shouldn't be this pushy. And from that point on, we just had to do the best we could, of course. The thing that I remember most about that place was the fact that when we got on the train in Jefferson Barracks to go to Chanute Field, by the time we got to Chanute Field, it was a cold, rainy day. This was the middle of August, mind you. And we were put in a tent city, if you like, on the grounds at the air base. And we walked in there late in the afternoon. And of course, it had been raining all day long. And we went to our cots that had big, thick mattresses on them. Every one was filled with water. The tents leaked like you wouldn't believe. Well, again, the country wasn't prepared for this. The Army wasn't. So we just had to make the best we could. I had a splitting headache the whole time. But somehow we all lived through it. And I think it was a couple of days after that when they started us to school. But in all my life, I'll never forget those first days there and those leaky tents, because that's all that was available. And we just lived with it. That was all there was to it, because we were in the Army. We couldn't get out.
Sure.
So,
did you establish close friendships during that time?
No.
No.
Everybody was changing all over the place.
Was there a lot of tension in the air?
Not a great deal, because again, we didn't know what was going on. We just knew we were being pushed a great deal to get through school. Mm-hmm. And they had, in the training that we had 2 weeks on one particular subject of aircraft design and maintenance work and that sort of thing. And normally they would give you 6 weeks on that. But they were just pushing for all they were worth to get us out of there. And finally, when we did finish and get our diploma, I was joined with a group of men that were shipped down to MacDill Field, Florida. We were there for only a short time. And oddly enough, we were supposed to be sent down there to get training on the desert, for desert warfare. So what happened? We go to England. It was crazy. Well, when you're in the service, you never know.
Sure.
But in any case, the thing that I remember, we were down there only about less than a month in Florida. And the thing I remember most about the next several weeks was that we were then shipped up to Fort Dix, New Jersey. And from there we got on the QE or the QM, I'm not sure which it was. I went both of them.
So it's the Queen Elizabeth,
exactly,
the cruise
Mary,
line.
The Queen Mary.
Or the Queen Mary.
Yeah, exactly.
Mm-hmm.
We had about... I think something like 6,000 troops on the QE or QM, whichever it was at that time. And the thing we all remember about that was that, of course, we were stacked up like sardines in the different staterooms. The ship was stripped down to the bare bones. And of course, we were only going to be on there about 4 or 5 days. But out in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean, of course, the Jerrys and their submarines were operating all over the place, and of course we kept our fingers crossed every day and every night. And this one night, the ship started to shudder real bad. It started to fishtail. And the idea behind that, from what we learned later, was that the operators of the ship, with whatever instrument they had, were noticing apparently that there were Jerry submarines in the area.
And you mean German submarines,
German,
right?
Well, mm-hmm. we call them Jerrys all the
sure,
time.
Sure, yeah.
German submarines is correct. And anyway, that's the reason that the ship started a fishtail. Now, there were two things involved here. First of all, the Jerry submarines had to operate underwater. That was all there was to it. They couldn't go nearly as fast as either the QE or the QM. And as a result, we outraced them, but at the same time, we had to do the fishtail to make sure that none of the missiles they fired were going to be able to hit us. So I think this went on two nights, as a matter of fact, on the way over. And of course, we were rolling from side to side in our bunks because the ship was just swaying all over the place during all this, but we made it.
Was there a lot of sickness at that time?
Not at that stage. Oddly enough, there wasn't. Mm-hmm. That came later on. But anyway, and I make in my outline here, I make point that by the time we got to Glasgow, the port of Glasgow was where we disembarked.
And that's Scotland?
Yes, in Scotland, yes. From miles out in the ocean, we could see we were in for it because the young people nowadays would never know about this, but there was no such thing as TV in that day and age. And what happened was that you saw the war by going to the theater to see the pictures flash on the screen taken by cameramen who were on the spot over there. And here we saw these giant balloons up way up in the sky, and these were what they called barrage balloons at that time of day. The British were doing everything they could to protect themselves from the Jerry bombers over there, Jerry fighter planes. And these balloons were up there, maybe half a mile or so in the air. They all had steel cables attached to them, and we knew this from seeing the newsreels over here. And they were attached to some foundation in the earth, and they were kept there all the time, and the idea was to prevent the Jerry bombers from getting in there and dropping their bombs on some of those areas, whatever they were. And when we saw those, I said, oh boy. Here we are.
Do you think reality set in at that point in time? Was it scary for you?
It was.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Very scary.
It was indeed.
And there were 6,000 of you on this ship.
Yes, interestingly enough, we talked with some men later on, and this was especially when we got down to North Africa. This was several months later. But we understood they had 20,000 men on some of those QEs and QM. They were packed like sardines, worse than we were when they came over. But there was no recourse. They had to be supplied over there. The U.S. officials, the soldiers, the officers had to be supplied with all sorts of manpower and materials, etc. And there was no choice, so they just packed them all in as all as they could and hope for the best, hope no subs got to them on the way across. And it worked out.
So your specialty was aircraft?
And engine mechanics, yes.
And engine mechanics.
Yes.
So you made it over to
England. Yes.
Mm. And how long were you there for?
About 4 months.
And what happened while you were there?
Well, oddly enough, not a great deal, because we as a ground force were stationed at an airfield north of London, about 90 miles. That was what they call the flatlands of East Anglia over there, and they still call it that. The difference is, though, that they told us, well, we're not sure when our planes are going. These were B-17s. At that time, they're called the Flying Forts. And in this day and age, they're peanutty things. But in that day and age, it was the only thing we had. It was the only bomber group that we had, although they did bring in some B-24s later on. The B-17s were already being made by Boeing. And they were being made apparently for the U.S. Army Air Corps, so that was what we were working with at that time of day. And when the planes did come in, it was about 6 weeks after we got there. So we had a lot of spare time on our hands and got acquainted with a lot of the civilian population, of course, not to mention some of the Tommies, as they called the British soldiers. And I'll never forget the one night. They had air raid shelters all over the place, and it was essential if you're going to survive the night sometime, because the Jerrys never cared where they dropped the bombs over there. And night after night, the Jerry bombers from the North Sea area would fly across our airfield and other airfields in the area. They were on their way to Coventry, England, where they were bombing the hell out of them over there. And I'll never forget this one night. That we were, us Yanks were out there, it was new to us, except what we'd seen on the newsreels back home. And we were fascinated by seeing these searchlights play in the sky and trying to catch up with the Jerry bombers and then see the ACAT guns going after them one way or the other. But we hadn't been there that first night. We hadn't been there more than probably 2 or 3 hours when we And we're all standing outside. We could hear the sirens going. We could see the searchlights playing there. And all of a sudden, I got picked up bodily and all the other ranks. And we said, buddy, don't stay out here. You're risking your life if you do. The British Tommies did that for us. And that was another indication of we were in it. We really felt the pressure from that point on.
It was sort of a rude awakening.
To see those bombers, you could hear the drone up there. Jets weren't available at that time of day. Mm-hmm. These were all the old, what we call the prop-driven aircraft, and you hear that roar up there all the time on the way over to Coventry or Birmingham, Brum as they call it over there. And it was quite an experience those first few nights there. And during the daytime, of course, they didn't bother coming over then because it'd be too easy to shoot them down one way or the other. But it was strictly a social thing from that point on for us. We'd go in to the town of Peterborough, which is about 20-25 miles away for us. And we'd even go to dancing there that night. And what amazed me about the social life there was how quick the British people picked up on jitterbugging over there. I was flabbergasted because a lot of the Yanks couldn't do jitterbugging that well. Sure. It was an amazing experience from that point alone, because we did, we had, for several weeks there, we had a pretty good social life. And then the aircraft came in, that was a whole different ball game. Then we didn't get out then at all because my outfit, now this was before the 8th Air Force was even formed. In fact, some of our buddies over there stayed behind to start up the 8th Air Force there, but the aircraft that we did have flew the first bombing mission over France at that time of day to the town of Rouen. It's R-O-U-E-N, I believe it is. And that was our first experience on actually having a bombing raid from our base over there. And of course, from that point on, the B-17 started to come in a big way all over the area. And that didn't go, I think it was early December then, that we then were leaving to go down to North Africa. We didn't know where we were going, but we did go down to North Africa at that point. We got in a big convoy out of Liverpool and took the train down, I shouldn't say the train, we got in a convoy. Convoy probably wouldn't mean much to anybody over here right now, but that time of day, everything was convoy that moved around because there were no aircraft to take anybody anyplace. These were all ships out in the sea, and by the time we got in our convoy, and on this occasion, it was in the port of Liverpool over there, I think there must have been 20 British ships lined up there to take all of us different ground troops down to North Africa, although we didn't know where we were going.
Now, would it have been not only American troops, but British
troops? There were some British there as well, yes.
And there was a good rapport between
you,
yes.
And
they were glad
yes.
to see
yes.
you?
Oh, yes, mm-hmm. yes, yes. By that time, we saw what the British had gone through, and we... better cut it off for a while.
Sure.
The interesting part about that convoy trip, about 20 ships. Before we got on board, we were given a little knapsack full of canned foods. And our officer came up to tell us now, said, "Now look, we're going someplace. I can't tell you where it is. In fact, I don't even know for sure. But we're going out in the ocean. And if we ever get kicked by a missile from one of the Jerry bombers or one of the missiles from the submarine, and you may have to swim to shore, this is going to be your food you're going to have until you get rescued over there someplace." Well, the interesting thing is here that now we're on board the ship, all British ships, and we learned right away that we didn't like British food, especially on shipboard. It simply wasn't up to our level. That was all there was to it. The standards that they had, the public health standards and that sort of thing. And I don't think we're on, I think it took about nearly a whole week to get down to North Africa from there because it was a slow going. In any convoy, the fastest ship had to slow down to the slowest ship in order to maintain the firepower of the convoy for any of them that got hit. So here we were slow boarding it down to North Africa. And I think the cans of food we had were all gone after the first 2 days. We couldn't take the food on the British ships. Mm. They fed us mutton all the time. And I thought, how in the hell can these people live like this, you know? But that's one of the things you just, they learned to live with it. They had to. So anyway, we finally made it down to the rock, as the British called it, the Rock of Gibraltar. And we went into the port of Oran. And this was another thing that was so amazing to me, that it was brilliant weather down there. And when we looked into the port of Oran and saw the buildings in there, we said, oh, this is beautiful. And we thought, boy, we're going to be in heaven down here with all the hot weather and all that sort of thing. Then we landed, and we started to walk through the villages, and they stunk. You wouldn't believe how they stunk. And I said, my God, how can these people live like this? Well, one has to remember that at that time of day, those were all occupied by the French. They were French protectorates. And they were all Arabs down there. And the French didn't give pennies worth to the Arabs at all. So as a result, the public health they had and all that sort of thing, we were very fortunate to get out of there, believe me, because the smell from all those places just got to us. So now we go to the...
It was a health issue.
Yes, it was. Issue, yes, right. Yes, yes. So now we go to an airfield, which was our bivouac area until such times we got picked up. We didn't know it, but we were going to end up next to the Sahara down there. And anyway, we were there apparently in the rainy season, because what happened was we had to put our pup tents up out on the airfield. Rain. We slept in rain and mud again. And the interesting thing about this was that, of course, what could you do? You know, you had to live. That was all there was to it. So about 2 days later, we were on the train, the French train, to take us down to the place right next to the Sahara where we were. And we thought, we're going to catch pneumonia sure as anything on all this because of all the cold rain and the mud we'd had to sleep in. And the raincoats we had, again, were just like everything else in the army at that time of day. Pitiful. You know, they all leaked. You might as well not have the things. And we, at one point, we stood on the landing waiting for the train to come through, and it was pitch dark, and the train was supposed to be there when we got there. It wasn't. We had to stay in the pouring rain for 4 hours. Let's go AWOL. Where are you going to go?
you could maintain a sense of humor through.
Well, you had to. Yes. You had to. Yes. And if you want to talk about girls, go ahead and talk about girls, because what's the sense of it? It's there were none around. Anyway, the point of the story is that now we do get on the train finally, and the next day we were on the way down the Sahara, but the train had to stop every few miles for whatever reasons I don't know. What happened was that the Arabs would line up out there with tangerines, bushels of tangerines. We bought them dry, absolutely. We ate those tangerines like you wouldn't believe it. None of us caught a cold at all. Not a one of us caught a cold. So let's keep those Arabs around here.
Sure, sure.
Anyway, we got down the Sahara then, and we didn't last there very long for the simple reason that every day during the time that we were there, the winds about 11 o'clock in the morning would start kicking up the sand down there. We'd have a sandstorm every day. Hot, sweaty, it was a mess. And the reason I call this out is that, again, there's nothing new about this in terms of desert warfare, but the fact is that our airplanes were there with us by that time. They flew down from England, of course, and our airplanes were there. But what happened was that the sand got in the carburetors. It just choked them. You couldn't fly them. And, you know, I don't think we had more than out of about 15 aircraft in our squadron. I don't think there were over about a half a dozen that were operational, because the sand just got in the system. And it just chewed the motors all to the devil. You couldn't even get the thing started.
So was it your responsibility and your group's responsibility to try to work on these carburetors?
Well, it was, yes, but it was so involved that we didn't get that much into it. What eventually happened was that the engineering officer we had said, hey, you guys can't do this. We're going to have to take those engines completely apart. We're going to have to send them what they call a mod station, and a modification station. I don't know where it was down there. I had no idea. They'd pull the whole engine off, send it to one of these repair stations, and work them over and then ship them back. By this time, we had already moved up in the Atlas Mountains up north. So now we were sleeping in the snow every night. But it got us away from the sand.
But were you ever wondering where is all this going, especially where you were supposed to be one that was working on the airplane?
I know.
Was that frustrating?
Well, it was, yes, but at the same time, they kept us busy doing a number of other things around there, so we were kept occupied most of the time.
Such as what? What was a typical day like?
Maintaining the aircraft in other conditions, as far as that's concerned. The inside of them, the outside of them had to be worked on one way or the other. It wasn't really what we'd gone to school for, but that's beside the point. It kept us out of mischief otherwise. That was all there was to it. And I remember, and I'm sure that anybody listening to this would get a big kick out of this thing, the government at that point, in terms of the food, we had big long wooden benches there where we ate, and when we'd sit down, it was very hot, and all of a sudden here would come the bees around us to have their share of the food. Now, a part of the food we had were big cans of marmalade, about this high, you know, the gallon cans or whatever. So we got smart on this thing. We took the lid of the marmalade off, put it way down at the end of the table, go to it, bees, and they did. They loved it.
So these are all things that you certainly didn't anticipate having issues with.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah. But things you never forget.
Exactly right. Mm. It was quite an experience. The only other thing that I recall from the North Africa campaign was that we, at one stage, see, the British forces were at the other end in Egypt, under General Montgomery, the British general. And they'd had a hell of a time of it there. It was an awful time, awful living conditions. And of course, the Germans were now in between us. And they had a sort of a two-front battle that they had to fight to maintain down there. And finally, I guess Montgomery got all the skills together that he needed and really started to push and was pushing the Germans back. Now, the closer they got to our area, the more active we had to get. And we still didn't have fighter planes down there. All we had were our old B-17s, the Flying Forts. So what we did was we didn't even load the bombs on them anymore, because what they were going to use the B-17s for, they only went about 150 miles an hour or something like that. They lined all the air crew up on there, put machine guns all over the thing. They had six machine guns turrets in there to begin with. And they would load all those guns fully loaded with all the bullets they needed, and they went into what they called Kasserine Pass at that time to push the Germans back and kill the Germans. They had to go in low level because if they dropped bombs from such a low level, they'd kill themselves. You know, the blast would knock the airplane out of the air. So we were fighting. I wasn't on the air crew. I was strictly on the ground forces, and the air crew that were on there had to man the machine guns. So they flew the low-level flights through Kasserine Pass there, and they manned the machine guns to kill the Germans that were coming our way. And the last thing I remember that was so emphatic and so, I could never get over this. Finally, the British forces, with our help, had pushed the Germans out of the area there. The Germans were getting back to Europe any way they could. All of a sudden, through our bivouac areas came some of the armored forces from the British, the tanks, mostly tanks, and we just stood there, us Yanks just stood there, our jaws dropped. We couldn't believe this. They came through riding, most of these were Aussies, Australians, and they came through wearing their goggles, of course, to protect them from all the sand that was still around there. I never saw such, how can I describe it? You knew the hell had gone through, and they were the nearest thing to death you'll ever see in a soldier still standing up. They looked terrible, and you know they didn't even wave to us. They were so tired, they were so beat, and as a result they just kept on passing right through our area, and they didn't even have the British flag on the turrets there. They had the stars on the side there to indicate the British forces. But other than that, it was these Australians going through, all of them were riding on top of the tanks, and they just saluted us like that when they went by, you know, and that was it. Never.
When you saw that, did you with your troops not only look on in awe, and obviously it disturbed you, did you then talk about it with each other, or was it a time when you kept it all in?
It's about 50-50, really. Mm-hmm. We did talk about it to some degree, and it was such a shock.
Sure.
To see the physical condition of those men.
Did it make you wonder, what are you really getting into?
Yes, mm-hmm. Yes.
So there must have been some fear involved.
Oh, there was. Mm-hmm. Oh, there was, yes. But they went on through our bivouac area. They had some other collecting point down the line in another part of North Africa. I have no idea where it was. But just to see, there must have been 10 or 15 tanks went through our area that day. And all the Australian soldiers were on top of it, you know, riding along. It's like we just saluted each other as they went by.
Oh. So was this in the summer of 1942?
Yes, it was.
At this point?
Yes.
Then you said that was one of the key things you remembered.
Yeah.
Then where did you go on from there?
From that point on, the war was advancing into Italy itself. We had been instructed even before the end of the war there in North Africa that Italy was next on the line, or actually Sicily was. And there was a certain amount of fighting that had to go on in Sicily to clear the Germans out of there. But from that point on, it was mostly pushing all of them over onto Italy. And the next thing I remember about the Italian campaign was that the infantry, we followed the 5th Army all the way up. Our Air Force group was always behind the 5th Army. That was under General Mark Clark at that time of day. And the Army got stuck at Anzio Beachhead. Now, over here, that wasn't given a great deal of play because everybody was really, by that time, getting revved up about the Normandy landings, etc. They knew they were going to be coming, months, maybe within the year after that. So you didn't hear much about the Anzio Beachhead over there, but that was hell on earth, too.
Were you involved in that?
Only from the standpoint of the bombing.
Mm-hmm.
No, Rome was at that point declared an open city. The Germans agreed with the American High Command that there would be no fighting in Rome, no bombing of Rome. But everything else around there, all hell broke loose. And we were constantly making bombing runs over to the southern part of Italy to drive the Jerries north from there. Which did happen eventually, but in the meantime, the 5th Army at Anzio Beachhead was trying to get in, but the Germans had them zeroed in from the hills around there with all their heavy artillery. It was a terrible condition there, and you know, there was nothing we could do about it except bomb the rear forces, and even some of the hills around there were occupied by the Germans, and they had full advantage of height in order to see the enemy coming up the trails or whatever they were. And it was pure hell there for the 5th Army. As a matter of fact, I met one fellow here, must be 15 years ago now. He happened to be a good friend of my brother-in-law. Both of them were natives of this area, as a matter of fact. And he'd been at Anzio.
Do you remember his name?
Oh, he lives in Canton. I don't know whether he's even still alive or not. Mm-hmm. I don't remember.
So when you mentioned your group helping only by way of bombing,
mm-hmm.
What would happen? What time of day would it start? Would you get the planes ready?
Mm-hmm.
Did you befriend the pilots?
Oh,
tell
well,
us a little bit about what might
actually the air crew and the pilots were on their own in this thing. They were separate in bivouac from us. What we saw of the pilots and the air crew or how scared they were after they'd been through all this. The pilots and some of the pilots in our group were just getting just like that before they ever got in the aircraft. They'd gone through so much of the AK-AK guns that they had to face when they went over to Germany or parts of it over there. And the fact that they were responsible for bringing that aircraft back with all those other men on board, some of the planes were so shot up they never made it back, and the pilots knew this is going to happen to some of them. It had to happen, and at that time of day, there I saw a picture. It wasn't in my group, but I saw a picture of one of our B-17s coming back, it was in North Africa where this happened, that the photographer had done a good job on this. He showed just the tail end of the B-17, and one of the German bombers or fighters, whatever, had done a kamikaze type of thing, and cut the back end of the aircraft, such as only about that much of the skin on one side of the aircraft still viable. There was a big crease, a big empty spot right down the side of it there, and the pilot still got it back. He just about crash landed when he got there, but that was a story on it. I should mention one other thing too, that when we were down next to the Sahara in North Africa, we had the occasion on this one morning, the Sirocco, as they call it there, the heavy sandstorm, had gotten in the ships overnight. We even put pieces of board up on the intake of the engine, the carburetors, to keep the sand out. That helped to some extent, but not completely. And on this one occasion, the B-17 started to take off. Most of them made it. We didn't even see this happen. The sand was so blinding at that point. But all of a sudden, of course, they were filled with, they had a full load of bombs on. And all of a sudden, this plane hadn't hardly taken off. I don't think it was more than a minute in the air. Kaboom! The whole plane went up. We didn't even see parts of the plane after that. Again, this was because of a severe sandstorm that we had down there. It just chewed everything up, and some of those planes should never have taken off. But again, that's wartime, so
they had no choice.
That's exactly right. You're given orders, and you go. That's it, one way or the other. The only other thing, getting back to Italy. When they finally cleared out the Germans in southern Italy, we finally went over, that is the ground forces of the Air Force, and we were sent to a place called Foggia, F-O-G-G-I-A. Mm-hmm. It's southeast of Rome, maybe 50, 60 miles, I don't remember now. But we had to laugh when we looked at this place. It was all mud. Here again, we're getting into rain and mud, and the way we were able to operate the aircraft from there was that the Army had, in the meantime, come up with some steel plates that had holes punched in them so the water would drain out of them, but they were nearly the width of the airport, and for a mile long, because it took quite a while for those B-17s both to take off and land. But mud all the time, rain. So by this time, though, we had cots that we were able to sleep on. We didn't have to sleep in the mud anymore. Praise the Lord for that. Anyway, it was at the end of all that that my number came up in terms of returning home. I'd been there, I think I was in Italy for about, maybe 8 or 10 months, something like that.
Were you relieved to finally be able to go home?
Oh my goodness.
Yes. Yeah. Now, in talking about all of this, there must have been quite a cultural awareness on your part. You had met up with the British, mm-hmm. the Italian, the French, mm-hmm. the Arabs.
Yeah.
And here you are, a young man from Kansas. Mm. That must have been kind of an awakening for you too. Yeah.
You'll never know.
Yeah.
One of the first things that impressed me, or depressed me rather, was in North Africa, which was still at that time a French colonial possession. And we had Arabs all around us all the time, simply because they knew that we had the goodies, good food, all this sort of thing. So they'd come up to us sometimes, even on the trucks when we were going out, maybe to watch a late night movie, something like that, at the mosque nearby. And one night, when maybe 3 or 4 Arabs came up there to the back of the truck where we were, here come along a French soldier, and they spoke in French, of course. We couldn't understand a word of it, but all of a sudden that French soldier took the Arab off like that with a rifle butt. I said, for God's sakes.
Mm. You weren't used to seeing that type of, do you have any idea what had been
No, it's just the way the French treated the Arabs over there. Mm-hmm. We found out after it was all over with. I said, this is just like the whites to the blacks in America. Mm-hmm. Exactly the same thing. And all of us GIs on board the truck that night couldn't get over it. And the other thing is that I thought about this for years now. It's small wonder that the Arabs hate our guts in many ways, because here we were over in North Africa on the side of the French, helping them out, and the French mistreated the Arabs terribly, absolutely terribly. And I told the men that, I said, how can we justify helping the French out except that we want to get rid of the Jerries first? But what's going to happen after we leave here? They're going to be going right back to what they were doing initially, and just making a mess out of the relations with the Arabs there. So it didn't surprise me a great deal what happened there one way or the other.
So it was a real cultural challenge for you, too.
You've got no idea.
Did you stay in contact with any of the men that you were involved with? Not at all. Are you involved in any organizations now?
No. I told the wife, I said, once I get out of the service, I never want to see a uniform again.
So you got word, you said that you had been in Italy for 8 months.
Yes.
And you got word that you were coming home.
Yes.
Did you come home on a ship?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Yeah.
And
that was out of England, as a matter of fact. I flew back to England first to get the ship out of there. I think it was out of Liverpool again. I'm not sure. But I think that was the other QE, QM, whichever way it was now. I don't remember that now. Which one was which?
And once you were shipped home, where did you come into? New York?
New York again, yes.
And then you came home to Kansas?
Yes. Initially. Mm-hmm. Actually, by that time, the GI Bill was in full force. And that was right down the line, because I had decided to go back to school anyway and become an engineer. And that's the reason I eventually ended up here, as a matter of fact, through my engineering education I had out there.
And where did you go to school?
The University of Oklahoma.
Now, was your wife from Kansas?
At that time of day, no. My present wife is my second wife.
Mm-hmm.
She knows all about this. I was married to a British war bride initially. I had so many wonderful experiences with the British, especially the young people over there. And eventually, in fact, she accompanied me. The reason I went back to England after I'd finished my tour of duty overseas was that we were going to get married up there in England, and she accompanied me on the Queen Mary, Queen Elizabeth, whichever it was, back to home. And this brings up a very interesting point here, too, that, and I have never been able to get over this. We went out to the Midwest, of course, and now I'm going to be starting back to school at the University of Oklahoma for an engineering degree. In the meantime, I have had my British wife meet all my family. And while many of them didn't come out openly in front of her and say it, some of them were so anti-British, it just amazed me. I nearly walked out on the family one time because of it. And one time we were having, this was about, I think, a couple of years after I was discharged, we were having a family get-together down in southern Oklahoma at my sister's place at that time of day, and all the family were there. I was the youngest of the group, of course, and several, I think some of them had a few too many drinks at the time, and they started to take it out on my wife. And I was fuming, absolutely fuming. I said, do you know what you're doing? You're nothing but a damn bunch of prejudiced people here. That's all there is to it. After what the British went through during the war, they saved our guts. That's all there is to it.
And what was it like for your wife? First of all, she's in a strange land.
Well, this is the point. Said, you know what? You're embarrassing the poor woman terribly. Mm-hmm. What do you think she feels about through all this?
Sure.
And I let my family have it. I told them, said, if our mother wasn't here, I'd walk out on the whole bunch of you and never see you again.
Mm-hmm.
I felt so strongly about it, you know, because I'd seen what they'd been through over there.
And at that time, you were in your 30s?
Late 20s, early 30s, something like that.
And how old was your first wife?
Oh, she, I think, was about maybe 4 years younger. I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
I really never hadn't paid that much attention to it.
And then at that point, you went back to school, the GI Bill?
Yes, on the GI Bill.
University of Oklahoma?
Yes.
She was with you?
Yes.
And then you graduated?
Yeah.
And?
I went back to England. This is another rather different story here. My major in college was aeronautical engineering because I've been in so much aircraft experience overseas in the service. And at that time, the government was cutting back severely on aircraft work over here, aircraft design work, that sort of thing. And it was all out in the Midwest, out in California anyway. And I wasn't particularly keen about going out there at that stage. So I told my British wife, I said, look, you're not going to like this, but I'm going to go back over to England because the aircraft companies over there are still going full blast. I think I can get myself a good job over there in aircraft design work. She didn't like it at all. You know, she, in the meantime, she'd gotten so accustomed to the good life over here that she just couldn't understand why I wanted to go back, because she was not a college girl to begin with, which is immaterial as far as I was concerned. She wanted to stay here and live the good life all over. She knew full well, and I knew full well, going back over there, that we weren't going to have the standard of living that we'd had over here. So in any case, we did go back over, and it was quite an experience then, because now I was a civilian. I wasn't with any other Yanks around. No one was around to protect me, shall we say. And that in itself was a tremendous experience for me. The first job I got before I actually found an engineering job was with a small lumber mill in England, in the town of Peterborough, city of Peterborough. I don't know whether you know it or not, but you cannot call any place in England a city unless it's got a cathedral there. That's the definition of a city.
I didn't know that.
When they got a cathedral. And Peterborough had a pretty nice little cathedral there. No one ever went to it, but you know, it's one of those things that, again, it's all government supported over there, the Church of England sort of thing. But in any case, I said, I've got to go back over there because there's nothing over here for me. So I went back over there, and that was actually when things started going downhill, because again, I had to be out in this job. But let me get back to the lumberyard thing.
Now, just go ahead. Here,
sure.
Did your wife go back with you?
Oh, yes.
But reluctantly?
Yes, oh, very reluctantly,
okay.
Yes. We got to stay with her parents, of course, and which was cheap living. But beyond that, though, I had to go out and get myself a job. So I got the job. I went down to the labor ministry over there, put my name down on the list, and I got a job in this lumber yard there, which brings up another point that there are I don't think I ever saw a wooden house over in England. The reason for it is very simple, that they have to import all the wood they get over there. Everything they do, all their buildings, wherever they are all in brick. But in any case, it turns out that when I was in this lumber yard, I happened to be working with a fellow about my same age. He had just gotten out of the service. He and I had a ball talking about our different experiences, him in the British service and myself in the U.S. service. And I was shocked at him, some of the things he said, because we got to talk with each other for hours over there. And says, you know, so I was one that voted against Winston Churchill when the time came. I said, well, I can understand why after seeing the way you people lived over here. But the thing of it was, he was in India practically all the time he was in the service. And he said, I saw what the British had done to India. They raped those people over there, absolutely raped them. And I said, well, now you know why we had the Boston Tea Party over here. He didn't even know. That's another thing. You know, so many of the British I met over there, when I eventually got a job as an engineer, as well as just in general population, they knew nothing about our history over here, absolutely nothing. And I said, where did you people go to school? I said, we know all about the British from our history books over here, but they knew nothing about it over here. As a matter of fact, the last few months I was in England, I was there for 3.5 years mm-hmm. on this occasion. And the last week I was there, I'd given my notice to the engineering company over there that I was going back home. And this was at the time that General Eisenhower had been nominated by the Republican Party to run for president over here. One of the British engineers at a very close desk to mine said, "Bob, I hope you vote Eisenhower out of office over there. Don't even let him be president." I said, "What are you talking about?" And he said, "Well, you can't stand a general over here. We'd never allow a general or an admiral to be in our position over here as our prime minister." I said, "Well, that's a difference, isn't it? We would."
Yes.
Said, "You don't know American history at all, or you wouldn't be asking, even mentioning a thing like that." And I said, "If you look over the real history of the American Republic, you'll find that there were several generals that eventually got to be president of the country. But they don't know that. As a matter of fact, we have some very dear friends of ours over here in Northborough who immigrated over here some years ago. We had a mutual friend over there, and that's the reason why we found out about them. They came here on the 4th of July weekend, believe it or not. I could tell you a whole evening story on that one. But anyway, I was talking with a husband. He had a job over in Worcester before he ever came here. And I have to laugh about this because his name is Keith Lane. I said, "Keith, I'm just amazed at some of the things that I found out when I was in England that the British people don't know very much about American history. You don't." He said, "Well, of course I don't. I'm not ashamed to say that. The simple fact is that we have so much British history we have to learn in school. Why should we be bothered by American history?" I said, "Well, you got a point there, I guess, because you don't know it."
That's true.
Well, on and on and on like that.
Now, when you came back after 3.5 years, mm-hmm. at that point in time, mm-hmm. did your wife return with you?
No.
Had you separated at that
point?
We
had at that point, yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so you came back to the United States, mm-hmm. having worked with an engineering company,
yes.
in England.
Yes.
And where did you settle at that point in time?
I had a job over in Worcester, as a matter of fact, waiting for me when I got back. The company at that time is called Riley Stoker Corporation. They're now they're called the Riley Division of some German company. I don't remember at all now, but they're still very active over there in Worcester.
And is that R-I-L-E-Y?
Yes, yes.
And Stoker is S-T-O-K-E-R.
K-E-R. Yeah.
In Worcester.
Yeah.
So did you settle in Worcester?
Oh yes, for a while, yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And you were a single gentleman at that
yes,
point in time.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay, and then what brought you to Natick?
It's very simple that there was a specialized aircraft job that was opened up in Boston at that time, and I thought, well, it'd be nice to get back in aircraft design work here. Well, it didn't pan out, but anyway, in the meantime, I had moved to Boston, and I guess I was with that company about a year, and the work didn't appeal to me. So I switched over to sales work sometime after that and was able to do pretty well at it. But anyway, in the meantime, I started going to a church in the southern part of Dorchester. And that's where I met the woman who is now my wife. She was a member of that church that I attended down there at the time. And we moved out to Natick about maybe a year or two after we got married, simply because my sales work at that stage required a more central location. And this turned out to be it.
And what year did you move to Natick?
I think it was in 57.
Mm-hmm. So what year were you discharged from the
45.
Service? 1945.
Full 4 years. Yeah.
How important do you feel the military service was for you?
Oh, changed my life.
In what way?
It gave me a perspective that I'd never had before. And I think about 10 million other GIs could say the same thing as far as that's concerned. And I learned to appreciate this country all the more.
It's okay, take a breath. You learn to appreciate the country because of the freedom that we have.
Some of it, yeah.
And the luxuries that we have.
That's everything, the whole package. It's so different. Absolutely so different that I couldn't help but think, and I didn't get to finish out on that story in that lumber yard over there in Peterborough. Mm-hmm. The Britisher that I worked with at that point, he'd not been out of the service more than probably a year at that stage. And we started talking about his experiences. He said, the whole time I was in the service, I was in India. And he said, you know, I can appreciate all the more that we were a bunch of robber barons over in India. And I just hate the Tories in this country because of that, because they were the ones that ruled everything in India for all those years. And I just hate what we did to those Indian people. That was all there was to it. So I'd never vote for the Tories again over here, the Tories being the conservatives, of course. And I said, well, I'm very glad to hear you say that, because us Yanks couldn't understand all this. But then, you know, at that point, I started writing back letters to some of my relatives over here. Not my family. My family still considered me the runt of the litter. And my cousins and aunts away from my central family, I started writing some letters to them about my experiences in England at that point. They just were absolutely flabbergasted by the things I wrote them about life over in England. They couldn't believe it. I said, well, believe it, because I'm living it. Things are, in fact, even nowadays, I've taken my second wife back over there several times. She has relatives in the north, so-called North Country, well, around Newcastle, etc. And we've been over to visit them a couple of times. And to give you some, have you ever been to England?
I have not.
The cost of living over there, there's just no comparison. We walked around shopping in some, not the malls, they didn't have malls at that time of day over there, but in the business district, we would see some ladies' shoes shown and the prices. My wife, her jaw dropped. She couldn't believe it, the prices on them over there.
Expensive.
Oh, terrible. Mm-hmm. A gallon of gas over there, way up there. The price of cars, 3 or 4 times what you had to pay for them over here. I said, well, there you have it once again. As a matter of fact, in my sales work here, my engineering sales work I do, I come across a lot of British young engineers who immigrated over here. And I started talking to them about it. I said, are you ever going to go back? Maybe to see my mother, but that's it. I wouldn't go back to that place and live for no amount of money. It's just not worth it. As much as I love the people over there, the standard of living is so much below what we can get over here. And I said, well, it just confirms what I had found over there anyway. And my wife saw that in so many different ways.
Sure.
They don't have the standards of public health that we have over here. I could take a whole day to tell you about that.
Sure.
One.
Now, you are just shy of 80,
yes.
And yet you're still working.
Oh, yes.
Full-time, yeah. Part-time?
Well, now it's part-time. I'm really doing the same job that I've done for about 20 years now, 30 years, but I've gotten my territory so well, how can I describe it? I've concentrated on it so much that I know who can do this and who can do that. So I don't waste my time on the road anymore, and the whole sales picture here has changed anyway. Do you know what we mean by cold calls in sales work?
I do, but if you briefly want to mention, in case some watching this video may not.
Cold calls are when you go up and knock on doors, they don't know you. You've never been there before.
Or the telephone doing.
Yes,
it
whatever.
The same way. Right.
Same difference.
Right.
The companies around here, and I don't know about the rest of the country, but the companies around here won't let you make cold calls anymore.
Mm.
So you have to get on the phone, make an appointment, and you're lucky in some cases, because if you go through purchasing like is normal, they're never home. You always have voicemail you talk with. And that gets pretty silly to me after a while. So I talk with engineers. I get the engineers on the line and said, hey, I got something special to offer you. And it works out beautifully that way.
Sure.
I've been very successful at it.
It's remarkable.
So I go out about twice. As a matter of fact, the last 3 days, I've been on the road with a foundry. I sell castings. Mm-hmm. And I've been on the road with an engineer out of Pittsburgh. Or I should say out of Pennsylvania, not far from Pittsburgh. And we went down the Cape on Tuesday because I had a big project going down there. Yesterday we went up to near Dover, New Hampshire, because I had a big project going up there. But I made those appointments well ahead. And I let the man in Pennsylvania know exactly what the itinerary was. It's worked out beautifully that way.
Well, you're to be commended, and I think that's probably why you look so young.
I tell everybody I drink a quart of scotch every night.
Whether
cut that
we
out.
Believe it or not. One of the questions in wrapping this up that we have asked a number of our previous interviewees is your thoughts on the differences of public opinion regarding the veterans of World War II, Korea, and the Vietnam War, and how they were treated publicly or continue to be treated?
Of course, all of us in World War II were a bunch of heroes when we came back. Regarding the Far East thing, I had a nephew that went in the Korean War, and I talked to him a bit about it. It didn't disturb him too much, and he came back in all in one piece anyway, so it worked out pretty well. What really disturbed me was the Vietnam thing, and I couldn't help but think of my feelings about Pearl Harbor. I was just finishing up at the A&E school in Schnitzelfeld, Illinois, when Pearl Harbor hit. And of course, none of us knew what was going on. And it wasn't for years afterwards that I started reading reports about the investigations that were taking place about Pearl Harbor. And it's been my feeling after reading all those different history books and the intent that the writers had about this, that somebody in Washington goofed up terribly in terms of communication on that. And also the same thing happened for Pearl Harbor. They got their wires crossed.
And in Vietnam also, you think?
I think the same thing happened over there. And I told my wife, I said, you know, this Vietnam thing, it can't help but trouble. It can't help but trouble every veteran that's been through the battles.
That they've all been through.
Yes. The problem was that I think we used entirely the wrong approach in getting to that to begin with. And they should have had a different general over there, maybe one like Eisenhower, because the man they had just couldn't cut it. That was all there was to it. I think that was where the big problem lay in Vietnam. We had good intentions. We always have good intentions. But the other side picked out the weaknesses that we had, and I think this was because of the generals we had over there running that thing in Vietnam, and whoever was responsible for the thing back here, I think they should have been tried for treason, as far as I'm concerned, because there were just so many useless lives lost over there,
sure.
Because of mistakes made from here and over there. And this has troubled me ever since I started looking at this deeply.
Sure.
So the only difference now is, and I just happened to see, I don't know whether you saw 60 Minutes Sunday night, on the different concepts that they have now for fighting these mini battles. Well, that's what they should have had over in Vietnam all those years ago. I couldn't help but think, and I told my wife, says, you know, the Indians, when the settlers first came to this country, the Indians had it in mind to do this business of hiding behind the trees and the stone walls, what we call guerrilla warfare. We should have done the same thing over in Vietnam, but we didn't.
Mm-hmm.
And we could have surprised them as much as the Indians surprised us at the time over there.
Sure.
And that's what killed the British over here during the Revolutionary War. Our soldiers, the Minutemen up there in Concord and Lexington, have you ever been out there to the statues?
Yes. One of the other questions I wanted to ask you as we do leave this afternoon is if you have any thoughts or one memory or anything, statement in particular, that you would like to share in closing, not only with the community who will be viewing this tape now or in the future, and future generations who may be doing some research, but also your family, if there's something that you'd briefly like to say.
Really, I'm just thankful.
Well, we're very thankful to you for taking the time and sharing with us some very, very interesting stories.
Okay.
Thanks.
Thank you. My pleasure.